two first-time candidates are vying for the House District 12 seat. House 12 covers the area between the easternmost suburbs of Anchorage and the Matanuska Valley communities of South Knick, Fairview, and the Butte. Republican Cathy Tilton and Democrat Gretchen Wehmhoff will be facing each other at the polls in November. Each candidate will have 30 seconds for an opening statement. Ms. Tilton, your statement, please.
Well, thank you, Alan. Thank you for inviting me here today. My name is Cathy Tilton, and I am a candidate for House District 12, which Alan indicated is the Butte, Chudiak, Iklutna, Peters Creek, and Fairview Loop. I am Alaskan. I came to Alaska with the military when my grandparents, when I was a year and a half old. I've lived in Anchorage, Chudiak, and the Mat-Su. I am pro-gun, pro-family, and pro-business, and I believe that the role of government is not to interfere in our daily lives, but to create an environment that allows business to be successful and provide essential services. I have worked in local government and have had my own business and spent the last 4 years working for the legislature. And I am looking forward to putting that experience to work for you in House District 12.
Thank you, Ms. Tilton. Ms. Wehmhoff, your opening statement.
Hi, I'm Gretchen Wehmhoff, and I was raised in Anchorage. I've lived in Kenai for 2 years during my first 2 years of teaching, and of course for the last 20 years I've lived out in Chugiak. I'm a retired teacher, a retired university adjunct, and I've always been involved in my community from Girl Scouts to Arctic Winter Games, and I believe and I'm excited because this is the ultimate community service to be running for office. I'm pro-people, and I believe that we can work with communities and work together to better our state, better our district, and better our children's education.
Thank you, Ms. Wehmhoff. Now I will ask a series of questions. Each of the candidates will have 45 seconds to answer. They will answer in turn. And I will start with Ms. Tilton. How, if elected, as a legislature, would you recommend further cuts for the state operating budget?
Well, one of the things that we did when I was working in the finance committee is that we took dives into the budget. We took the health and social services and we divided it up by the divisions, and we held public hearings and got public testimony. We found out from those divisions what their missions and measure statements were, what they were doing good, what they weren't, and then we were able to look at those things and make long-term decisions that could give us some long-term sustainability in the recommendations that we made in cutting those places.
Thank you. Ms. Wehmhoff? Yeah.
You know, we've been cutting the operation budget as deeply as possible. I don't know how much more cutting we can do on some programs. Some programs have been cut to the bone, but I do think we need to think about our revenue sources and how do we bring revenue back into the operating budget. We have a growing population, we have a growing population of seniors, and our education system has been cut, cut, and cut. And we need to find a way to not cut education anymore, but to fund it. So I'm looking at other areas for cutting the operating budget. There might be a little room left, but we have been nailing it down as much as we can.
Thank you, Ms. Wehmhoff. My second question, will direct it toward Ms. Wehmhoff. Fish. How can the state work to alleviate the fish disputes? We have Cook Inlet fisheries disputes. We have restricted fishing due to Chinook declines, and we even have a motion on the table somewhere to perhaps bring state management into halibut fisheries. Ms. Wehmhoff, do you have solutions?
Yeah. You know, that's actually a very good question, because what we're doing in our fisheries is we're pitting commercial fisheries against sports fishing and fisheries against fisheries. And I think we have a lot of education to do, because we do know scientifically that a lot of our problems with our fish returning also has to do with the spawning areas. We have a lot of work we need to do with educating the public on it's not just commercial fishing, it's not just sports fishing, but we need to be aware of where our fish are spawning when we're out riding our ATVs, which my husband and I have an ATV, we just haven't been out enough. But, you know, where are we crossing streams? Are we going downstreams? And what we can do to work with each other. I'm a mediator, and I truly believe that pulling the parties together to find a solution is far better than trying to look at each other and blame each other. We need to work together.
Thank you, Ms. Wehmhoff. Ms. Tilton?
I think a lot of the things that are going on in our fish, and some of them are federal rules and regulations, that there's not a lot that we can do about as far as here in the state level. But there are different user groups, and each user group has its own, brings its own things to the table. The commercial do, there's the employment that they bring to the table, and there's the economy that they bring into the, and then there's the sports fishermen, and then there's, you know, our personal use fishermen. So I think what we do need to do is to be able to bring everyone together, and as you know, as a consensus builder, someone who can bring those groups together and have them talk with each other to come up with solutions.
Thank you, Ms. Tilton. And my third question has to do with Alaska's fastest growing group, senior citizens. Apparently in the country we have more senior citizens per capita. But senior housing is very scarce, and as a legislature, how could you help ensure adequate housing for the state's oldest citizens, Ms. Tilton?
I think one way we can help to ensure housing for our seniors, and our seniors are definitely a group of our population that we do need to take care of, looking at providing housing through our housing authorities and what have you, to get seniors into housing that is going to be, I'm trying to think of what I'm trying to say, but they need, you know, we need to have a special kind of housing for them that is adequate for the needs that they have and what they're going through. I just was able to go on the Meals on Wheels run throughout our valley, and I got to see several of where the seniors are living in their housing situations, and I think that is definitely something that needs to be a priority that we consider.
Thank you, Ms. Tilton. Ms. Wehmhoff?
You know, definitely, I think creating senior housing is going to be good for the economy as well as creating jobs. So what we have is the situation where I believe we should take AHFC. I know we're talking about a home trust to bring funding available for seniors. Right now, seniors come into different areas, and they, you know, we grow older, and then we get to points where we just want to be a little bit more secure, a little more safe. And then we get to places sometimes where we need extra care. It's that middle ground that we're really looking for, is that where can seniors live and how could it impact the economy, and where can they go? You know, I've spent a lot of time working with seniors with the Long-Term Care Ombudsman's Office, and my mother, I had 14 years with her Alzheimer's journey. And the things I saw remind me of how much we are not prepared right now for our growing population. So I do believe that economically we need to provide jobs and build these homes.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Wehmhoff. My last question, and I will direct this to Mrs. Wehmhoff, Ms. Wehmhoff first. Energy, rural affordable energy. How can we provide rural affordable energy, especially in the Mat-Su, where the population is escalating?
You know, that's another good question. We've had energy issues, obviously, in the entire state. We know that sometimes your energy bill is going to be higher than your mortgage payment, and that's something we need to consider. An LNG line, you know, if we could get it down, perhaps if we can help with the infrastructure in the interior, we'll be able to help those communities attach on to that LNG line. In the valley, in addition to having that opportunity with the LNG, we also have so many natural resources out there that we could be working with. We have wind, we have water, and I really believe that we should be helping the outer communities develop renewable resources. We have so much wind in Alaska. If you've ever been to Barrow, you've got the wind. So we should really be helping with renewable resources.
Okay, thank you so much, Ms. Wehmhoff. Ms. Tilton?
I think that the LNG line and AGDC is looking on a couple different projects that would help to bring energy in not only to the valley but also into different parts of our state which are really have really high energy costs. Another thing that I have been looking at is talking with our local electrical authorities and understanding that it's not that we don't have enough power, it's that we don't have the transmission lines and the infrastructure to get the power out to the people. So those are some other things that we could look at as in building infrastructure. So, you know, building the LNG lines or some sort of gas line, and then maybe looking at building some, helping with the infrastructure and the transmission lines and our power.
Thanks, Ms. Tilton. Now it's time for candidate questions. Each candidate will ask the other a question. There will be a 45 seconds allowed for an answer, and then the questioner will get 30 seconds for a rebuttal. So let us start with Ms. Tilton, your question, please.
So Gretchen, we've talked about that the budget is not sustainable as it is, and that there does need to be maybe something, and you know, bringing in revenue is definitely one idea. What is it that you would consider should be something that we should do to create a sustainable budget?
You know, I think we need to still explore the concepts of where our money is coming in and how we direct it. You know, right now we have a lot of situations where we have fees and we have taxes, sin taxes, as we call them, you know, the smoking tax, the alcohol tax. You know, where does that money go? Does it really go to the agencies that deal with these issues? Or does it simply go to the general budget? You know, how are we dividing that money that we're bringing in? I think we also need to look at the possibilities. People have talked about creating funds for different areas out of our major fund, permanent fund. You know, that's worth exploring. Are we ready to do that yet? No, I think we still need to work on what we're doing in the capital budget area. I think our capital budgets are far too high, and so I think bringing that down and putting into the operating budget where we can sustain it, we'll be better off. We're outspending on our capital budgets.
So, your rebuttal, please.
Yes. Well, so when we look at the capital budget, I think that what we need to look at is we need to look at finishing what we started, and we need to look at maintaining what we already have. And I think that when we're looking at our capital budgets and the requests that are coming in for those are really important, and a lot of, and not really necessarily looking at what our wants are, but what our needs are for our communities.
Thank you, Ms. Tilton. Mrs. Wehmhoff?
Yeah.
Your question, please.
Yes, actually, back to the budget. I know that, Cathy, you've spent a lot of time in the Health and Human Services budget. That's mm-hmm. something you spend a great deal of time in. And yet we are talking about seniors. We're talking about mm-hmm. the programs. We're a state of, you know, 700,000 plus, but less than a million, and we have this growing population. How can we, what cuts, when we're cutting the budget, how can we also expand the operating budget to take care of this growing population?
Well, I think that with your own budget, you can't really cut your budget and expand your budget, you know, and you can't cut yourself into prosperity. We all know that. So when we're looking at how can, I think that maybe reprioritizing the things that we do have in our budget to meet the things that we are required to do as a state by our Constitution, and then of course taking care of the people who are our most vulnerable citizens who do need to be taken care of. So we have to look at kind of reprioritizing funds, not so much as not to rob Peter to pay Paul, but to look at that reprioritization and look at the missions and measures and the goals of those particular programs and how we can make each one of them work.
Ms. Wehmhoff, do you have a rebuttal to that?
Yeah, I am concerned that our operating budget gets cut continually to the point that we're not taking care of our education mandates. We are mandated to educate our children, and yet we can continue cutting that. And we, in the same situation, we're cutting our services, APS, you know, Adult Protective Services, Office of Children's Services are obviously overwhelmed. They all could use more help and more staffing. And I'm wondering, how do you prioritize when everyone is asking for that? And I really truly believe that our capital budgets have gone a little bit out of control. And that if we could cut down on some of our capital budgets, we may have to pull back on some, that we might be able to work with that.
We'll need to end it there. Thank you, Ms. Wehmhoff. And your second question, Ms. Tilton?
So when you're talking about the capital budget, let's just stay on the budget. So if you're looking at the capital budget, what is it if you're looking at the capital budget and you're looking at education funding, and you know, I'm always asked, would you fully fund education? Let's move there. You know, and fully funding to me is a hard word to explain, because I just have a challenge with fully funding. So how do you feel about fully funding?
Well, I believe education is the cornerstone of our society. Mm-hmm. I believe that if we educate our children from an early age, from pre-K, and take it all the way through into our university system, which is actually a pretty dynamic system, and it has really met the needs and continues to try to meet the needs. We need to fund so that if we have kids graduating, if we have kids succeeding, we know that we're going to lower our crime rate in the end because we have a more educated community. We're also going to improve our economy, because we're educating people to become part of our citizenship in our economy.
Ms. Tilton, you have a rebuttal?
educating the children, and I agree with education, and I do agree with education, but I think that there is a difference of opinion in fully funding and what that means when it comes to what it means from the legislator's viewpoint, what it means from the educator's viewpoint, what it means from the administration's viewpoint. So I think that that is just somewhere where all the groups, the user groups, need to come together to discuss what is best for our citizens.
Thank you, Ms. Tilton. Ms. Wehmhoff, your next question.
Yeah, I think I'll actually stay on education. My granddaughter started kindergarten with 24 kids in her class. I met another kindergarten teacher in the Matsu who had 26 in her class. And for people to try to comprehend that, that's 52 shoes to tie, 52 mittens, 52 gloves. But 52 eyes on you. But 26 children that are 5 years old, and we're trying to work with them and teach them the routines and prepare them for education. What would you do to reduce class size in the sense of funding?
Well, I think that one of the things that could help, and one of the things that we do very well in the Matsu Valley and maybe a little bit different in the Anchorage School District, is that we do have a lot of choice. And in that choice, people have a lot of choice whether they want to do homeschool or there's charter schools or things like that. That can help reduce the classroom sizes in the public school scenario.
Okay. Ms. Wehmhoff, do you have a rebuttal to that?
You know, I believe that both Matsu and the Anchorage School District have a great deal of programs. They have several programs from young ages. They have immersion programs. They have special technical programs. So I think that's a good deal. But we still have a situation that when you have students go into a choice, you still have that major population of students. So choosing where to go, how does that fit the entire group? How do we make sure that every student has a better relationship with their teacher because their class size is smaller and they are able to have adults in their life that are meaningful, those
Thank
relationships?
Thank you, Ms. Wehmhoff. Now there's a time for another question from me and the moderator, and I would throw it out there. What is your stand on the marijuana issue, Ms. Tilton?
My stand on the marijuana issue is that in Alaska we have a fairly libertarian attitude towards marijuana. Unfortunately, the way that the initiative is written at this time, I have some challenges with, and I would not support the initiative the way it's written. I think that in Colorado, even the governor has come forth and said that he is not happy with how, and there are loopholes in that initiative. And I think that there just needs to be a little more time looking at that before we move forward initiating something like that. Although, you know, it is up to the voters, and so what the voters decide is what we will, you know, what we will work with.
Thank you, Ms. Tilton. Ms. Wehmhoff?
You know, that is the one situation that I have been struggling with very much. In many ways, I wish Colorado had been doing this a little bit longer as we're watching. I think that would be helpful. And also as a high school teacher, you know, you could talk to students and they'll say, you know, it's really hard to get alcohol. But you know what? If you need something, in 10 minutes, we'll be back. The kids know how to find these things because this marijuana and everything is so readily available when it's not regulated. So I am struggling with it. My answer is I'm leaning towards yes, but I am also looking at the other end. So I'll probably be struggling for the next week or two.
Right, thank you. We'll have to end it there. Now time for closing statements from our candidates. They each have 30 seconds for a closing statement. Ms. Tilton?
Well, my name is Cathy Tilton, and I would love to put my experience that I have to work for the voters of District 12. I have private business experience, I have local business experience, and I have worked in the legislature on over half of the state's budget, and so I have that experience as well. I would love to put that experience for the voters. I also have been to your homes. I have talked to a lot of you out there, and I am more a better listener than I am a talker, and would love to do
Thank
that for
you. Ms. Wehmhoff?
Yeah. I absolutely would love to have your vote when it comes to November 4th. And of course, remember, you can vote early. I am a member of this community. I have been the response I've received when I've gone to doors has been fabulous. People want to be involved. They want a legislator who listens to them. They want to feel that their voice is heard. I believe in communities. I believe we need to do everything we can to bring our communities into our decisions in Juneau, and I truly believe that I'm someone who can do that for you.
Thank you. Mrs. Wehmhoff. And those are your candidates for House 12, Cathy Tilton and Gretchen Wehmhoff.